knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
With groups 1 and 2 covered, we have completed the S block on the periodic table. Now it's time to hop over to the P block and continue learning about more of these elements. Under the numbering convention we are utilizing in this series, this is group 13, which we can refer to as the boron group. It includes boron, aluminum, gallium, indium, thallium, and nihonium. These elements have electron configurations ending in NS2 NP1, and it is with this group that we begin to see more varied properties in reactivity. They have moderate Z effective values and a range of ionization energies. Boron and aluminum can make 3+ cations, while the rest can make either 1+ or 3+ cations, with the 3+ being more common, except for with thallium, which tends to prefer the +1 oxidation state, due to the inert pair effect, a phenomenon that describes the tendency of the outermost S electrons to remain inert in certain elements very low on the table. Also, with boron, we encounter our first metalloid, and boron will prefer covalent bonds. The rest are metals, and aluminum also has a considerable tendency toward covalent bonds, though it also makes ionic compounds. Gallium, indium, and thallium have borderline ionic and covalent tendencies, with the metal cations becoming increasingly stable going down the group. In terms of availability, boron is found in ores like kernite and borax. Turkey holds about 72% of the boron deposits in the world, though California also houses a significant share. Aluminum is the most common metallic element on Earth, found primarily in the ore bauxite, which is prevalent in Earth's crust, but also in cryolite. Gallium is found in the form of trace impurity in bauxite and some zinc ores. It has an unusually low melting point and will tend to melt in one's hands. Indium is leached from slag and dust from smelting zinc ores and is also found in ores of iron, lead, and copper. Thallium is extracted from slag and flue dust from the smelting of similar ores. Nihonium is the first synthetic element we will discuss, a transactinide element, one of many elements on the table that do not exist in nature, but was created in a particle accelerator, in this case in 2012. Its most stable known isotope, nihonium-286, has a half-life of about 10 seconds, so it has no practical applications and we will not say much else about it. This will be the case with most of the transuranium elements. So how are these elements prepared industrially? Boron can be isolated as an amorphous solid from diboron trioxide using magnesium. Aluminum can be prepared through the Hall process, which is the electroreduction of aluminum oxide in molten cryolite. Gallium, indium, and thallium are prepared by electrolysis from aqueous salts. In terms of the chemistry of these elements, boron is perhaps the most interesting, mainly due to the flexibility of the covalent bonding it can participate in. This has to do with the dominant S character of its valence electrons, which allows for good flexibility in bonding directions. Elemental boron tends to be crystalline, built up of B12 icosahedra. There are several allotropes that differ in the way these icosahedra are packed, and they are quite inert, reacting only with hot oxidizing agents. Boron can also take on an amorphous form, making random networks of bonds, and this is more reactive. Boron commonly forms trihalides, compounds which are used as Lewis acids, as we may remember from organic chemistry. With these, a lone pair can be donated by a Lewis base into an empty p orbital to form a fourth bond. These bases can include amines, alcohols, water, and many others. Boron's most interesting chemistry comes in the way of its hydrides. The simplest of these is B2H6, or diborane, a colorless pyrophoric gas, meaning it ignites spontaneously in air. If this Lewis structure seems a bit off to you, it is for good reason. We see two lines stemming from these two hydrogens, seemingly implying that they each make two covalent bonds, which we know is impossible. it is actually the case that these are bridging hydrogens, and these are 3-center 2-electron bonds, abbreviated as 3C2E. This means that these two lines together represent only 2 electrons, as do these two. So each boron is still really only making 3 bonds total. In this series, we will be seeing a lot of examples of bonding that defy our prior conceptions of how covalent bonds must be. So just take this in stride for the moment, and we will clarify further a bit later. Higher borions are more cage-like, and they involve still other strange bonding behavior. Terminal 2-center 3-electron boron-hydrogen bonds, 2-center 2-electron boron-boron bonds, closed 3-center 2-electron boron bonding, and so forth. This is how boron can bond to more atoms than one might expect, given its 3 valence electrons, in order to form a wide range of borane structures. Some of these common cluster structures include closo, with a boron on every corner of a closed deltahedron, nido, which is a deltahedron without 1 vertex, and arachno, which is a deltahedron without 2 vertices. Boron also forms carboranes, or boranes with CH+, substituted for certain BH groups, amine boranes, which are analogous to alkanes, and borazines, which are analogous to benzene. Boron has a number of applications as well. Borax is used in laundry detergent, as it chelates or binds calcium and other ions in so-called hard water, which just means water with high mineral content. It also prevents copper salt formation, which we know of as soap scum. Boron has utility in buffers for biochemistry, as fire retardant and welding flux. Boric acid is used as a cross-linker for silicone polymers and is a common insect killer. Boron nitride is isoelectronic and isostructural to diamond, so it is as hard as diamond, but less expensive and more heat resistant. And boron carbide is one of the hardest known substances. In fact, secret agents used to put this into automobile oil in order to destroy engines by abrasion. Moving on to aluminum, this is considered an ideal metal for industrial application. It is extremely light and strong, so it is used in many airplanes and spacecraft. It has excellent thermal conductivity, it does not rust, it resists corrosion, and it is relatively cheap due to its abundance. Aluminum oxide is used to prepare synthetic corundum gems. Aluminum oxide with chromium impurity makes ruby, and with iron impurity makes sapphire. Aluminum is also present in the synthetic beryl gems that contain beryllium, which we learned about in the previous tutorial. And of course, everyone is familiar with aluminum cans, aluminum foil, and other such products, while aluminum halides will be familiar to organic chemistry students as important Lewis acid catalysts in organic synthesis. Gallium has utility in the alloy galenstein. This is 68.5% gallium, 21.5% indium, and 10% tin. This alloy is a liquid all the way down to negative 19 degrees Celsius, and often used in place of mercury in thermometers. Gallium is also used in semiconductors and LED lights. Indium has utility in indium tin oxides, which are transparent conductors of electricity used in LCD panels and computer displays. Thallium sulfide is used in photoresistors, as this material changes its conductivity when exposed to light. Thallium is also used as a fluorescent dopant in gamma ray scintillation detectors. And finally, as we said, nihonium is too radioactive to even be stored for any significant span of time, let alone have any real practical application. And with that, we have completed our survey of group 13 on the periodic table. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.